Israel, the way forward is to return. And the same thing could probably be said about America at this point. I think a return to America's founding principles would be a very good thing. I will lift up my eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help comes from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. And that's Psalm 121. In the beginning, adding up the numbers. The 14th of May, 1948, 80 years ago, Israel was miraculously reborn. It was as if finally a great light had begun to shine amidst the darkness of World War II. Unwavering in its resolve, bright in its infancy, smug in the ancient cradle of Western civilization. For many people in Jewish communities the world abroad, the rebirth of Israel was like an answered prayer that salved, yet could never soothe, the horrific memory of those great and terrible labor pains. Was the founding of and independence of the State of Israel and the capability to defend it not a gift from God? If so, what right has anyone to rend God's gift in twain? It were better to rend our hearts in humility than to tear apart that which God has joined together, for a house divided against itself cannot stand. Whether the fulfillment of an ancient prophetic tradition, a reality that had imitated the art of some divine messenger, or simply an idea whose time had come, the independence of the nation of Israel was forthrightly purchased through the honest hardship and long-suffering of her people. Today, the people of Israel and all those who look to the hills of Zion, in the hopes of a coming of a final redemption and the building of a third temple in Jerusalem, face daily the threats of those who would seek to defame and twice annihilate her legitimacy. Not only the legitimacy of statehood, but the legitimacy of the very essence of Jewish and Judeo-Christian culture, which is the Law and the Prophets. In these best and worst of times, where astonishing historic and prophetic imagery seems to be a day-to-day occurrence, with one ear to the ground and a never-fixed gaze upon a hauntingly apocalyptic horizon, both Jews and Gentiles alike are lifting up their eyes toward the hills of Israel, even to Jerusalem, in the hopes that she would soon become what she was destined to be, a light unto the nations, a light that shines forth in the midst of the darkness. God said, "Let there be light," and there was light, and God saw that the light was good. 5141948. Call it a coincidence that God's name appears 32 times in the first book of creation. Call it the fulfillment of a prophetic vision. Call it a dream that imitates the art of a divine messenger. Call it an idea whose time has come. Call it what you will. But it's no mere coincidence that the Jewish tradition has transcended the test of time and continues to inspire and shape the world in its own unique image and likeness. For indeed, God created man in his own image, but mankind in God's image has not really been formed. And what I mean by that is, if we look in the Bible and we see God's plan for creation, man living in peace, and then we look out into the world and what do we see? We don't see peace, we don't see harmony. We see, in many cases, utter chaos. So, mankind in God's own image has not yet truly been formed. He's not finished. He's still creating. And I think that's a beautiful thing. So, for the lack of imagination of those who wish to push aside Torah and the prophets or diminish its teachings as illegitimate basis for leadership or argument, for those who cannot take a stand or do not wish to take a stand, or feel the incessant need to apologize for taking a stand, those who are like the proverbial dog in the manger, because the dog doesn't eat, and neither does he suffer the cattle to eat, and all of them go hungry. Here are just a few examples of the creative dynamic power of the Judeo and Christian philosophy throughout ancient and recent history. Israel's greatest kings, David and Solomon, studied the law of Moses, the Torah.